Hey guys, Dagan here from PMTV UK, and here's how you get that rockabilly sound. Now, I'm not claiming to be an expert at rockabilly style guitar playing. It's really unique, and people have dedicated their entire lives to learning that specific style of playing. But there is one thing I do know, and that is how things sound. It's got a very unique sound, rockabilly. It's kind of country, but kind of not. They use a similar kind of setup. It's mostly in the style of playing and the era in which it was created. So in this video, I'm gonna show you guys the best guitars to use, the best effects, and the best amplifiers. But in saying that, you can get that kind of style through anything really, because it is all about swing. Rockabilly is about swing. People joke on saying there's only three chords in rockabilly. And in most cases, there is, but it's hard to get that unique rockabilly sound with those chords. It's all about the swing. It's kind of 12 bar bluesy, because rockabilly was created back in the day when swing was the in thing. Everyone was going out dancing. Everyone was dancing to that 12 bars beat, and rockabilly was well up there with what people enjoyed. So the gear I'm using today is kind of era specific, if that makes sense. Obviously there's some daft pedals up here, including that one, which I want to talk about more in a second. But the gear is kind of era specific. When you look back and see people playing rockabilly back in the day, they've got the big Gretsches, they've got the Telecasters, they've got the Stratocasters, and I'm going to tell you why they're good for the genre. But if you've got a BC Rich Warlock, you can probably play the style of rockabilly through a clean amp and it'll sound good. The first thing I want to talk about is delay. Slapback delay is very prominent in the old rockabilly scene. That very quick kind of snap, which makes it sound like you're doing more than what you're doing, but it gives us that extra kind of swing to make your foot tap. What I intended on using was one of the Dunlop MXR Echoplex pedals, a replica of an old Echoplex, big old delay, tape delay. I'm in an Active guitar store and that sold this morning. I couldn't find another tape echo besides this bad lad. This is the T-Rex Replicator tape echo. It's a big, faithful recreation of a tape echo, but I'm not going to use it for this entire video. I'm going to change it to a Boss DD3. And before you rage quit this video thinking it needs to be tape echo for rockabilly, it kind of does. That lovely warm tape echo needs to be a thing, but I want to make this video suitable for everyone. Not everyone can afford this crazy tape echo T-Rex replicator pedal. And I wanted to try and throw something modern in the mix as well. One of the most common delay pedals on the planet, the Boss DD3. This is the new version, the Boss DD3T. So I'm gonna rock a slapback echo on this pedal and retire this replicator. So that is the DD3, a modern digital delay, just to kind of throw something in the mix to show that you haven't just got to use vintage style gear, besides the fact that I couldn't get a hold of an Echoplex delay, to get the kind of rockabilly sound. Slapback is literally just a slap back from the note you just played. Now there's loads of different songs out there which require different delays for rockabilly, but that's kind of the most prominent and popular. So without the delay, still sounds good. Again, as long as you play in the style of rockabilly, that very percussive, swingy kind of 12 bar. You get that kind of sound, but the slapback delay certainly helps. Means you can play less notes, to be fair, because the delay is doing most of the work for you, and you can concentrate on where you're gonna go next. So let's kind of work backwards from the delay now. I just wanted to show you and get rid of the big expensive T-Rex replicator, which is amazing, but not accessible to everyone. And I'm sure, well, because back in the day, there was only tape delays available, hence why that's the rockabilly sound. I'm sure if clean, crisp, clear digital delays were available back in the 50s, they'd use these as well for lovely, clean slapbacks. I said work backwards, but let's work backwards from this amplifier as well. It is mic'd up with an Aston microphone Stealth as well, which is a beautiful microphone going into your lovely ears. I've chosen to use the Fender Blues Deluxe amplifier because it's got a lovely kind of tweed sound to it. Fenders are very prominent in the old rockabilly scene, along with AC30s, AC15s. Again, solely because that was what was available back then. You see a lot more of these kind of amplifiers rather than Marshalls because they've got quite a mid-range poke. These have a lovely kind of scoop mids and they fit rockabilly really well. You can't go wrong with a modern day Blues Junior, Blues Deluxe, if you can afford it, a Fender Twin, and everything in between. Even some of the new modeling amps like the Mustang GTX50 have some amazing rockabilly presets already set in, so you haven't even got to buy all the pedals. So that's why I chose the Fender Blues Deluxe reissue, because back in the birth of rockabilly, Fender amps were very accessible and they kind of shaped that sound, and you can still get them made pretty much the same way and sound today in 2020. Also, spring reverb is very crucial, so let's move on to the next pedal, which is the Strymon Flint. If your amp hasn't got reverb, spring reverb is crucial, and I really enjoy the Strymon Flint because not only is it one of the best sounding spring reverb pedals on the planet, there's also a built-in tremolo which was used quite a bit in rockabilly, which I'll turn on in a second. But I'll show you what it's like without this digital delay on and with no reverb. Where's the control? There it is. So this is totally dry going into the Blues Deluxe. Kind of there, again it's got the swing. Amp spring reverb. And now the Strymon Flint. Beautiful sounding spring reverb pedal that I got going to the front of the amplifier because this amp is on clean. It's best to run a clean amp. Again, we'll get to some dirt next to it shortly. But you can, with the amp running clean, you can run everything into the front of the amplifier as long as you have your time-based effects towards the end. Nothing's going to get too muddy. You haven't got to put anything in the effects loop. So I'm now using the Strymon Flint reverb solely instead of the amp reverb. I'll turn that DD3 back on again. Great sound. And if you want to add a little bit of flair, I've seen many a rockabilly player in my little bit of research use an old school Leslie or a tremolo or a vibrato pedal just to get a bit of get a bit of flutter on it. I'm just playing chords there so you can hear the old tremolo on its go. And when you mix it in with some chord playing, it's a subtle thing to have. And I went for the whammy bar there, the lovely Bigsby on this Gretsch again, which I'll speak about later. And it kind of makes up for not having a whammy bar on your guitar if you were a Telecaster user. You got a lovely kind of vibrato just underneath your playing. Alongside that, I have an overdrive. Now, overdrive isn't a common thing in rockabilly, but it's nice to have a little bit of fluff on, and I wouldn't recommend using anything like a tube screamer where there's a mid-poke in between a very brittle sounding overdrive. I've chosen the double-double overdrive by MXR because it's kind of like a full frequency overdrive. It's not necessarily peaking one bit. The whole thing's just kind of lifted, and I've got the drive quite low down. It's only on 9 o'clock. So this is without overdrive. And just a little bit of fluff does sound great. So again, when you're finding an overdrive for your rockabilly sound, don't get anything with a mid-range poke. It needs to be a nice, full, transparent, all-frequency overdrive pedal. This one does a great job. Next to that, I have a TC Electronic Spark, which I'm using as essentially a clean boost, and that clean boost could be used in two aspects. You can use it with the overdrive on, so you can add a little bit of something, a little bit of secret seasoning to your overdrive. A bit more grit to it. Or or you can use it as a lot of people just intend to use it as, when there's no overdrive behind it, it simply works as a clean boost. And I like the TC Spark because there's built-in EQ controls and also a gain, but I'm not using a lot of gain, and the little switch in the middle isn't a treble boost, isn't a bass boost, it's a clean boost. So simply for when you want to rock your solos. Backwards probably wasn't the best way to go around this, but I wanted to start with a delay because it was very important. The first pedal you hit is equally as important, and it's a compressor. I've chosen the MXR Studio Compressor because back in the day, compressors weren't readily available as a pedal. So when rockabilly artists were playing live, there wasn't a lot of compression. However, when recording them, if you were hearing them live, there wouldn't be a lot of compression. Whilst recording them, there was a lot of outboard gear, and the gear they used back in the 50s and 60s gave a lot of natural compression. Okay, so in order to achieve that natural compression, these days you have to use a compressor because we found a way to record things naturally. And this has been on the entire time. Not too much compression, just a little bit. And I enjoy the MXR Studio Compressor because there's a little LED screen up top. It shows you how much compression you're actually getting. So when you go gig to gig or move from guitar to guitar, you can keep the same amount of compression to make this part of your rig sound exactly the same. So those are the crucial pedals and amplifiers I would choose if you want to set up a nice little rockabilly setup for yourself. Lovely studio bass compressor just to get that natural kind of compression that was used to record back in the day. A boost pedal for when you want to boost for solos and to get a little bit more EQ control for when you do play single notes as opposed to the chord work. An overdrive pedal to add a little bit of seasoning on some of the stuff if you want it. Again, you can pair it up with the Spark to get a bit more grit. Spring reverb, well, if your amp doesn't have it, get a lovely spring reverb pedal. And a bit of tremolo as well to add some flair and some flutter for your, to your playing. And if you don't want to use a Bigsby, that's great as well. And finally, one of the most crucial parts, the delay. Whether it be an old school tape echo, a modern digital delay, they all do great things. Just give it a bit of a slapback. Again, slapback isn't in everything, but it's crucial for that rockabilly sound. Amplifier, get yourself a lovely Fender clean amplifier, whether it be a small one or a big one. It'll all do the same thing because Fender was around at the birth of rockabilly, and it's very important to have a lovely clean amplifier. This, a Vox, again, you don't see many Marshalls. And last but certainly not least, the most important part, the bit you actually touch, the guitar. A lot of the time you will see artists use hollow bodies, mostly Gretsch hollow bodies, but any hollow body will do. Gretsch is just great because of the Filtertron pickups. P90s are great as well. This is a Gretsch G5422TG, fully hollow, no center block, maple front, back and sides, maple neck, rosewood board with 22 medium jumbo frets, and black top Filtertron pickups. Now, Filtertrons are great because you need a lot of bite when you play rockabilly stuff to kind of cut through and mess with the bass player and play along with the bass player. These guys have the poke of a single coil, but the warmth and the hum-canceling nature of a humbucker, so Filtertrons are great. Telecasters are great, Stratocasters are great, you can use humbuckers, but I think the ideal guitar for rockabilly, check out any iconic rockabilly artist, they're always using a semi-hollow, is something like a Gretsch. And I'm going to compare this in a second to a Stratocaster and a Telecaster to show you what it all sounds like through this rig, but fully hollow is cool as well. It adds a little bit more low end, especially with the pokey Filtertron pickups, to kind of give you that all-in-all rockabilly sound, and a lot of the time you are using the bridge pickup to get that bite and to cut through what your lovely bass player is playing. Just hasn't got the same kind of poke, has it? It has to be the bridge pickup. So that was the Gretsch G5422TG, fully hollow, the electromatic range as well. So it's not the most expensive guitar in the world, but it's the best Gretsch to get with these Filtertron pickups. The Streamliner series will look the same and give you a similar kind of vibe, but they are humbuckers in that guitar, so they'll have a lot more poke and a lot less brightness, but obviously it will still work. It all boils down to your lovely rockabilly playing. So this is a Squire Telecaster, an Affinity Telecaster, not one of the most expensive Telecasters on the planet. I think it's just over £100, but you do still get that twang because of that lovely Telecaster bridge pickup. The reason I thought I'd use the Telecaster is because you haven't got to have a Gretsch to play rockabilly, or a big semi-hollowbody with filtertrons, I should say. It's not just Gretsch. You can't get anything, and this is a Squire Affinity, not a lot of money, and it's kind of accessible to everyone. But I will say the filtertrons do sound more rockabilly to my ears, and it's all about flair, isn't it? Rockabilly is about flair, big loud shirts and big loud guitars, and the Gretsch is just, it's like the Cadillac of guitars. Get yourself a frilly shirt on and a Gretsch and you'll be playing rockabilly like no man. And because I haven't got a Bigsby on the Telecaster, I'm going to turn on that lovely tremolo. Haven't got a Bigsby, but it adds a little bit of... Very cool. I love these tremolo pedals, and these do sound great for rockabilly, to be fair. So finally, the Strat, the last of what I believe to be the best rockabilly guitars, because of that bridge pickup. But the neck pickup does sound good as well. I don't know whether I'm delving into country and blues, but... it could just be because of the neck pickup on this beautiful 60s Vintera Strat. Sounds so good, but the rockabilly sound... is the three chords and the bridge pickup. So the rockabilly sound is essentially three chords with lots of swing. You've got to get your foot tapping and a lovely bitey bridge pickup, slapback, clean amp, studio reverb to keep everything nice and level, spring reverb. That's it. Just make sure you're swinging, guys. And that you've got a loud top. You've got to get a loud shirt. And if you get a loud shirt, please comment down below what kind of top you've got, because I want to know where I can get my loud shirts here in the UK for rockabilly. That was a lot of fun. Hopefully it helped you guys craft your rockabilly sound. Clean amps, slapback, bright bridge pickup, you'll be there. As long as the foot's tapping, like I keep saying, it's very crucial. Get that foot tapping, get that slapback going, and you'll be right as rain. Hope that helps. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to PMTV UK on YouTube for lots more cool guitar and music related content. If you want any more information on any of the products I've spoke about here today, get yourself to the new PMT website, pmtonline.co.uk. We are PMT House of Rock on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook. Give us a like and a follow to see pictures of everything with a nice filter on. I've been Dagan, and I shall see you next time.